Thank you very much for the opportunity. Today I will speak about the raw material composition of Polgár-Csoszhalom in Northeast Hungary. So, Polgár-Csoszhalom is one of the key sites of the Hungarian Late Neolithic period for several reasons. Firstly, it was inhabited in a region where influences from multiple directions could meet with each other. This fact is reflected on one side by the mixed material culture of the site, on the other side by the dual nature of the settlement. Tell and circular ditch system in the same locality represents different traditions from the south and from the west. Secondly, with 3.5 hectare excavated area, this site is one of the biggest researched horizontal settlements from the period in Hungary. This circumstance, together with the huge amount of archaeological remains, gives us the possibility to examine the social relations and structures from many aspects. Focusing on the subject of today's presentation, there were only two preliminary papers concerning the chipstone tools of this site complex. Katalin Tibiro drew a general picture about the raw material kit on only a selected part of the collection, while Erzsébet Bácskai published a short report about the user analysis of the retouched pieces. The complete evaluation of the material is still in progress, although we have interesting results through the detailed examination of the 18,000 pieces of the tell and the flat settlement. So here you can see the amount. In the case of the flat settlement, more than 95 of the chipped pieces are from the limnic quartzite types originating from the Tokaj Mountains, which are 50-70 kilometers away from the site. Among them, three main subtypes could have been distinguished thanks to the MA thesis of Adrian Sexagy and the comparative collection of the Institute of Archaeological Sciences of Eötvös-Loránd University. The remaining 5% showed important connections with territories 250-400 kilometers distance from Northeast Hungary, namely Transdanubia, Krakow-Częstochowa Plateau, the Holy Cross Mountains, and the region of Volhynia and Podolia. Contrary, the excavation of the tell yielded chipped pieces from distant sources more than 15%. Moreover, one of the three subtypes of limnic quartzite, the mesozombor type silex, ruled the assemblage which is connected to the southern side of the Tokaj Mountains. Having a closer look on the outer part of the site complex, Thyssen polygons were created by the central points of the features in order to visualize the distribution of the chipped finds. This distribution showed that the most prominent features are scattered evenly all around the excavated part of the settlement. This situation proved to be valid in all three subtypes of limnic quartzites, the obsidian and the distant raw materials also. So here you can see the limnic quartzite type 1 and its distribution. The next one is obsidian, it is scattered all around evenly. And the next one is distant raw material sources, namely Krakow Jurassic flint. The statistical comparison of the three main raw material types revealed further information. The correspondence analysis showed that most of the features were arranged in two raw material clusters. The one on the left side represents more from the mesozombor type limnic quartzite, which originates from the southern slopes of Tokaj Mountains. So, this accumulation. The other cluster on the right side of the plot contains those features in which the majority of the northern types of the limnic quartzites were deposited. So, putting these raw material clusters on the map of the settlement, it became clear that they are distinct spatially as well. The northwestern and southeastern areas belong to the southern raw material cluster, while the remaining middle zone is the territory of the northern raw material cluster. Advancing to the spatial analysis of the tell, one of the first built structures were chosen in trench 4. The house number 11 was erected as a two-story building which had been deliberately burnt just at the beginning of the formation process of the mound. Different amount of chipped finds can be attributed to each levels of this burnt structure, but two main characters can be noticed. The mesozombor type silex always rules the assemblages and there are no pieces of distant raw materials. So as we advancing, these are the amounts of the finds. these are the bottom level. As reaching the bottom level of the building, distribution becomes uneven because the lowest floor level remains without any find. This strengthens the supposition of the clearing of the building before the burning process. The features in the closest vicinity of the house kept significant amounts of the chip material. So the features around the house contained 66 pieces. But still no distant raw material occurred. One more strange observation needs an explanation, which is the extremely low number of burned pieces directly from the burned debris of the house. It could mean that either the house was totally emptied before the burning event, or the crepping activity didn't take place in it at all. The lifetime of the flood settlement were analyzed through 74 AMS samples, which were obtained from graves, post holes, wells and pits. Following the resulting dates, four main phases were reconstructed. As the map indicates, every corner of the settlement showed activity during its full lifetime. The material of seven different features, pits, was analyzed to observe the raw material economy of chipped stones from a temporal aspect. These features contained enough quantity to represent three from the four main phases as the obtained AMS dates correspond. As the chart shows, apart from small fluctuations, the raw material distribution remained even throughout the 250 years of the flood settlement. The type 1 lignite quartzite was the most abundant, which was followed by type 2. This means that the most of the raw materials came from the northern side of the Tokaj Mountains, and the same amount from the beginning to the end. Concerning the vertical stratigraphy of the tell, it could yield more appropriate information about the correspondence between the lifetime and the raw material composition of the settlement. Trench 4, situated in the middle part of the tell, contained less quantity of chipped stones, around 1,100 pieces. At the bottom, no distant raw material was present, as we saw the case of house 11 before. Starting from the fifth level, which is a thick filling layer in the sequence, chipped stones started to be more numerous. In the same time, the ratio of the distant raw materials became more significant. The amount of the chipped stones connected to the different layers show an alternating pattern. The layers abundant in finds are followed by layers lacking material. Comparing these results with those of trench 3, the same phenomena can be noticed. However, chipped stones were found in it three times as much in trench 4. More and more distant raw materials occurred above the level 8, which is contemporaneous with the thick filling layer in level 5, trench 3. So, if you see the saturation of these blue colors, you will get orientation. So these are contemporaneous, these two layers. The general raw material composition is the same in the two trenches, namely the most abundant is the mesozoic type silex. The following aspect is about those finds which are likely connected to activities beyond everyday practices. In these cases, simple statistical and spatial methods are not enough to reveal the original motives inherent in the action. Regarding the burials, altogether 124 graves were excavated at the flood settlement of Polgár-Csoszhalom. Only a handful of them contained chipped stones as true grave goods. Most of them were males, deceased in their 30s, accompanied with one complete blade and or several blade fragments. Typologically, these latter were retouched in most of the cases, which makes them belonging to the category of trapezes. The preferred raw material was the lignite quartzite from the Tokaj Mountains, only two pieces associated with the chocolate flints of the Holy Cross Mountains in Poland. So these are from distant raw material, this piece and this piece. Apart from the appearance of distant flints, these two graves did not contain more spectacular grave guards as the others. One more attribute which connects these pieces is the general patinated state, which origin is unknown and it needs further explanation. A third similar example came up later in 2005. This time a large chocolate flint blade was situated near the skull of the deceased person. So it is from a later excavating season. The case of feature 139 is yet another example of structural deposits. This feature served as a well once, and then it was filled up with numerous carefully deposited vessels. The chit stones connected to it do not show any significance for the first glance, at least concerning their raw material. They are all belonging to the well-introduced limnic quartzite except one piece. This latter is an otherwise robust radiorite raw material chunk, whose origin probably connected to the Buc Mountains some 50 kilometers from the site. Taking a closer look on these pieces, it is obvious that the products of the different stages of the Chain operator are arranged from bottom to up. Core and raw material are followed with debitage products, then the retouch tools on the top. The meaning of all of these can be hardly explained with practical reasons, because obviously these pieces don't belong to neither to the same raw material nor to the same debitage process. The next concern is about the used excavation methods. The material of the tell is a result of a careful screening via the flat sediment yielded finds from a rescue excavation. In this sense, their comparison could be problematic, but the material of the stratigraphic unit 205 in pit 44 from the flat sediment offered a great possibility. Using only ordinary excavation tools, shovel and spade, 89 pieces were collected from this feature. In order to look for further finds, all of the respective soil went through a careful screening. It is less surprising that chip stones were unearthed like this more than 20 times as much, and the average size became 1 cm less in all dimensions. What is really instructive is how the ratio of the different raw materials changed. For example, there were no obsidian pieces without sieving, but more than 300 occurred with this more precise method. Moreover, only one more piece of distant origin came up. This case study forces us to handle with care the distribution of the obsidian on the settlement. In the conclusion, so clamping activity relied mainly on the sources of the Tokaj Mountains, as we saw it. Flat settlement part shows even distribution through space and time, so I suppose clamping activity was taking place on the household level. Tomb constant ratio in the raw material composition and lack of unworked raw chunks in the assemblage, which makes us conclude to place the acquisition on community level. Tell settlement part shows uneven spatial distribution, cleaning of the floors and or clapping activity outside the houses. The tell settlement part shows an uneven temporal distribution, so connections with distant sources got stronger through time. Raw material composition ritual context remains the same on both individual and social level, so it may take place at the highest organization level of the community. And ratio of obsidian is excavation method dependent, at least at this settlement, so analysis of this raw material is uncertain. Thank you very much for your attention.